And welcome to Cheddy Free Church on this Sunday, the 19th of February. Where should we start? So, how are we all? Beautiful sunshiny day. Oh, it does so much good, doesn't it, to see the sun? And the snowdrops. I think everywhere that I've been walking recently, I've been seeing snowdrops. Cherry blossom? Golly gosh. Snowdrops, crocuses. Crocuses, I don't really see the point of a crocus. It's such a pathetic flower. But snowdrops are beautiful, aren't they? sorry. Crocuses are beautiful. Thank you, Lord of the Crocuses. They're just very weak, aren't they? And they sort of look damaged so quickly. This morning we're going to be focusing on mission. Pete's going to be speaking to us on our next passage in Matthew as we continue in our study in Matthew. Anne isn't here this morning, so I was hoping that Anne would do the notices, but in the absence of Anne... Everybody looks a bit shocked, like they're a rabbit in the headlights. So I think we've got quite a lot coming up in March. March is a really busy month. But this week, we've got Monday messy church planning at Brenda's house at 7:30. Tuesday, we've got open home here at the church, pancake party, pancake tossing races, pancake tossing competition, pancake races, eating pancakes, pancake quiz, pancake word search, everything pancake themed basically. 6 o'clock here at the church. On Wednesday we have prayer meeting. Monday, Wednesday, Friday we've got Warm Hub, open space, whatever you want to call it, open door, whatever that is called. Thank you to the Cottinghams for continuing to do that. I think it's been a real blessing, hasn't it? I've only been in a couple of times very briefly, but it's always been so nice to, it feels like a lounge in there, it feels homely, and people are having the place that they can come and sit and have a chat and have a cup of tea, and you know, having that contact with each other during the week I think has been really nice, hasn't it? Thank you to the Cottinghams for your time and energy. So Wednesday, warm space, prayer meeting here, 11:30, 12:30. Thursday, generally Thursday is our day off, isn't it? We get a quiet day. Friday, anything on Friday? Oh, Warm Hub again, yeah. And then Saturday, the Corleys go on holiday. Yay! We're going to North Wales for a week. Next Sunday, is it you, Pete?
Yes.
Pete's speaking to us again. Lovely. And then as we go into March, we've got lots of things. We've got Songs of Praise, we've got Mother's Day, and we've got Andy Dutton's 60th birthday party at the end of the month, to which everybody is invited for lunch. It's on a Sunday after the service. So lots to look forward to in March. We're going to sing our first hymn, which is All People That on Earth Do Dwell. So let's focus today on the words that we're singing and the words that we're going to be hearing.
Oh,
choice, Dave. Wow, wasn't that amazing? To think that here in Chailey Church, we joined with some enormous cathedral of people singing, or the orchestra and the trumpets. Wow, amazing. And the line that made me smile in that hymn was, hymn serve with mirth.
Yeah.
I guess that means hymn serve with joy. You know, we think of mirth as humour, don't we? But serve God with humour and joy and happiness. I think that's a wonderful line. Serve him with mirth. So, little story from our house this week. Last night we watched a film called The Circle, which had Tom Hanks and Emma Watson in it. And it was a bit weird. It wasn't a great film, but it wasn't a completely rubbish film. It was the idea that in a dystopian world, gradually over a period of time, one particular company that develops technology gradually gains more and more control over people by having people sign up for their system. And therefore, it became more and more that there was no freedom of will and all that sort of thing. But one thing that struck me in it was that there's one point at which Emma Watson, who's having a bit of a troubled time, she takes a kayak that isn't hers and goes kayaking in the dark, and she gets into trouble. And because there is one of these all-seeing little tiny cameras that are now everywhere on the top of a buoy that she happens to pass in the dark and it sees her, a helicopter comes in and rescues her. And the big boss of the company, which is called The Circle, interviews her the next day and says, how are you feeling? And wasn't it amazing that we can see everything now, everything is open, everything is out there and seen, that you were saved by that. And she becomes hooked into the company then by saying that all this all-seeing, all-knowing, all-knowledge known to everybody is good. And one thing she says, because then she does this presentation to all the company employees, and one thing she says is, or she's asked is, do you behave better when you are watched? So does knowing that you are being seen all the time make you behave better? And the idea is that you will eradicate crime by everybody knowing that they are seen all the time. Because she said, yes, I behave better. If I'd known I was being watched, I wouldn't have taken the kayak. You know, I wouldn't have gone out and done something stupid. And then it made me think, although this is that in that story it's about technology, for us, we are seen all of the time by God. And we need to, how many times do we think that we're doing something secretly? Or we do something that we know is wrong and we do it because we think nobody can see. And we forget that God sees everything. And God just doesn't see our actions or hear our words, he sees inside our hearts. So even if it's just something that we think or feel and it doesn't actually come out, God sees that, doesn't he? So in Matthew, where Jesus says, it says, do not commit murder, but I say, don't even be angry. And it really made me think that we should challenge ourselves, not just this week, but all the time, to remember that God sees us all the time. And it should therefore mean that we want to behave better. Not just because we're being watched, but because of who is watching us and who that God is and how much he loves us. And as wanting to be more like him. And today's message is about mission. And I think mission is a really challenging thing. Being told to go out and share your faith with people is quite scary. But again, God sees us. God sees us in the tiny bits that we try. God sees us in everything that we do. But he also sees the times that we don't say anything. And that, again, should be a challenge to us. Just wanted to share that with you. Really struck me. I wouldn't necessarily recommend the film, but it was interesting. That really struck me. We're going to just come to the Lord now in prayer, and then we're going to sing Amazing Grace. Lord, I thank you this morning that you bring us here as a church family, that we can meet in freedom, in a country that is at peace, in a world that is so often at war. Lord, we can get fearful by all sorts of things. We can become afraid of technology. We can become afraid of disease. We can become afraid in so many different ways, Lord. But I pray that we can that we will lean on you, that we will remember all the time that you are in control, even if the world feels out of control, that you are in control. But Lord, help us today to focus on all the people out there in the world that don't know you, and what that then means, Lord, for their lives and for their eternity. Lord, I pray as we think about mission that you will give us the courage and the faith to step out for you, Lord, to speak for you. Because every person that doesn't know, every person that never hears is lost. So, Lord, I pray that you'll be with us today, this morning, in this, as we think about challenging things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So we're going to sing Amazing Grace.
Forever mine will be.
We're going to come to our time of prayer. And I think there's lots of things within our church that we're doing actively, like our warm hub and our messy church and everything. Lots of things there to pray for, because those are a part of our mission from this church. But I think there's also things within the lives of people in the church that's going on at the moment that we should pray for. So I know there's Andy's dad, who's unwell. The Matthews family have got COVID. Other people, I'm sure. Has anybody else got any stories? That Jeanette?
So it doesn't look good.
Okay. We will pray for him, Jeanette. Anybody else? Penny?
I'd like to pray for my husband, Steve, who has been quite poorly for quite a few weeks, and it still hasn't improved. But he did say this morning that it's not so painful now, because he has oedema, and... But he does
ache.
Okay. So I have to look after him to a certain extent.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm thankful for anyone's prayers for him.
Okay, we'll pray for Penny's husband. Anybody else have anything to pray for? We've also always got things to pray for, haven't we? Yeah. So anybody that's on our heart, anything that is on our hearts, let's bring it to the Lord as we come together in prayer. Particularly they're praying for the mission of our church as we go forward. So if you just pray as you feel, and then I'll close at the end.
Lord, I just pray. Jeanette's private done, Lord, has got all these medical issues going on, Lord. I just pray for your healing hand touching, Lord, to lift him up from these horrible things that are happening, Lord. And I just pray that in Jesus' name. And I also pray, Lord, for Andy's dad, Lord, that he would be coming home soon. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Dear Lord, I do pray for my sister who's going through chemotherapy at the moment, and I praise your name that she's pretty chilled out about it, and that you've given her that peace of God that passes all understanding. Naturally, she is a worrier, and so is her husband Marty, but Lord, I pray that you will give them that peace and joy, and pray that you'll give the surgeons and all that deal with her the skills and the ability to help her in her troubles. Pray for her whole family, and thank you, Lord, that David has been given permission to come from Mexico to visit his mother for a month. And so, Lord, we thank you for that, and pray for that family and bless them. Thank you for their witness for you. In Jesus' name,
amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, I pray, Steve, I pray, dear Lord, that he will realise that there is a God. I pray, dear Lord, that he will one day, you know, have salvation in his life. I lift him up to you, dear Lord. But thank you, dear Lord, for all your help for me, for giving me the strength to look after him. And I lift him up to you. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for all our loved ones who don't know you, whether it's our children or our partner or parents or whoever it may be in our family, Lord. We just pray that you will, through our prayers, you will touch those people's lives, you will break down barriers that have been built up, you will soften their hearts, Lord. So that they can come to know you in this lifetime. Lord Jesus, these are people that we love most passionately in our lives, and therefore it's the most painful when they don't know you. Lord, I just pray that you will work your power through people's lives today. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Dear God, we thank you that you are able to help those ones that we love who are in pain and in need. But we also think wider, and we've got a community around us full of people who need help and are in pain and need. So pray help us as a church to reach out
Thank you for the blessings you've given us through Warm Hub and Mercy Church and other outreaches. We pray that we can reach more of our community and help the people who need the most. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And dear Lord, we do thank you for this day. Thank you that you set a day of heart that we can come together from the daily toils, Lord. We thank you that you've blessed us as a country. Lord, we have so many blessings, Lord, that we, when we look at other countries with all their difficulties and their problems. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you will give each one of us a forgiving spirit. For Lord, down through the years, we have often hurt somebody who perhaps feels uncomfortable. We pray, Lord, not only for ourselves, but for others, that they may have a forgiving spirit also. We realise, Lord, that we live in a world of sin. We live in a world where hatred to your word and your name, and where there is much rejection of your word today. Oh Lord, we do pray that you will open the eyes of the blind, that we may see Jesus, not in a physical way, Lord, but through our hearts and our minds, that we may see what he's done for us. He gave himself a ransom for many. Lord, we thank you for that. Where would we be without the cross and the shed blood of the Lord Jesus? Amen.
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 Dear Lord, I bring Cootie to you today, Lord. I thank Phil and Sarah for coming down to looking after her. To make her better, Lord, and make sure she's got lots of friends around her today, Lord, in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, we also want to remember Ted Hill.
Yeah.
Not sure what's going on with him, but he's this problem with his eyes, Lord. Just pray that you'll be with him and with Anne, who are missing today. Just pray that you'll be your power will be in that situation, that you will guide the work of the consultant and the medical people in knowing how to treat him. In Jesus' name, Amen.
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 Well, thank you for the work of this church. Thank you that we are a church who want to be and hope to be and work to be active in our community. Lord, I pray that you'll give us all energy and creativity and every power and skill that we need, Lord, to be able to reach people, to respond to your call to go and to spread the word about the gospel of Jesus Christ in Chamberlain. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
I found the absolutely perfect hymn for today, but I couldn't find a tune that we knew. And although some of the older people, or some of the other people in the church, I don't want to say older necessarily, may know some of the older hymn tunes, Dave and I really struggled, because all we could find was an instrumental, and we really struggled to sing along to it. So I didn't include it, but it was Go Forth and Tell, O Church of God, Awake.
Oh, yeah.
Which of course some of you do know, but the words were absolutely perfect for today, but we're not singing it. But I want to read a little bit of it for you. Go forth and tell, O Church of God, awake, God's saving news to all the nations take. Proclaim Christ Jesus, Saviour, Lord and King, that all the world his worthy praise may sing. I mean, they're really wonderful words, and I'm sad that we couldn't find a tune. Go forth and tell, O Church of God, arise, go in the strength with Christ your Lord supplies. Go till all nations his great name adore and serve him, Lord and King, forevermore. Wonderful, wonderful words. Maybe we can find a tune another time to sing that one. We're going. Sorry? You'll hum it. Oh, Janice will hum it. We can all come really close and listen. We're going to have our reading. where we are continuing in the end of Matthew chapter 9 and into Matthew chapter 10. Starting at verse 35, so just at the end of where we were last week, where Jesus had driven out some demons and the crowd were amazed. So Matthew chapter 9, starting at verse 35. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim the message, "The kingdom of heaven has come near." Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. No bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or staff, for the worker is worth his keep. Whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person and stay at their house until you leave. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it is not, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, leave that home or town and shake the dust off your feet. Truly I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. I am sending you out like sheep among wolves. Therefore be as shrewd as snakes and as innocent as doves. Be on your guard. You'll be handed over to local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you'll be given what to say. For it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death and father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. You'll be hated by everyone because of me. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. When you are persecuted in one place, flee to another. Truly I tell you, you will not finish going through the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. Amen. And before Pete comes to speak to us, we are going to sing "The Servant King."
So Over the next 2 weeks, this is a two-parter, episode one and episode two. We're going to think about our mission, and this is our mission part one. So the next week we're going to look at more of the nuts and bolts of mission, but we're going to look this week particularly at how Jesus saw mission and how he would like us to see mission. So I looked up the definition of mission. There's lots of different definition, but the definition that would fit into what we're here today about a biblical mission, a mission that is related to our vocation, our life, and the way that we live, is this. It says a mission is a vocation or job or calling of a religious organization, especially a Christian one, to go into the world and spread its faith, the Christian mission. That's what it is. Now, when I came here first, I remember meeting Brenda Barnes here, lovely Brenda, and even today she talks about coming down to the mission, because this was known as the mission, wasn't it? Well, actually, that's good, because we are Chailey's mission, and we're about what we should be doing. And Jesus goes forth in these verses, and he shows us a direct way of following him. Now, this week, at the top of the road, our road, they had somewhere down just the top of the park. If you know where we are, there's a bit that's a road, and at the top of this road, somebody was having a new drive put in. So on Monday morning, I went up, and they said, "Oh, we're going to close the road." I said, "Okay, we're going out. We'll be back later." He said, "Oh, well, that'll be finished by then." And then when we come back, we were met by all these directions. Now, directions here are clear, but the directions here, well, it said, diversion ended, diversion begins. And then it said, road closed. Well, it wasn't. It was obviously open. There was a little gap for us to go through. And at the bottom of the road, it said, road closed. And then it said, diversion that way, diversion that way. And then round the corner, it said, diversion ended. Isn't that a bit like our life sometimes? We have so many different signposts in that. But Jesus does never do that. He gives us a clear indication what he wants us to do. It's ridiculous. Most of them have fallen over in the wind, which is good, actually. It's much clearer now. But Jesus leaves us no doubt what he wants us to do. But who is this mission for? Who is it for? Well, Matthew 28, verses 16 to 20. It's his final words to his disciples before he went into heaven. Jesus said this: "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee," because there was no Judas or Iscariot, "to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age.'" Now, that's the Great Commission as it's told to us. But I've heard people say, well, that was to his disciples. That was to his disciples. And what's amazing here, which I hadn't really realised until I read it again, that there's 11 disciples here, and even among them they doubted it, and they'd seen all everything that happened. But that's an aside. But the Great Commission was for everyone to be involved. And you listen to Paul, Paul's epistle to the Corinthians, and he's talking about this in 1 Corinthians 5:20. He says this: "We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though through God we're making this his appeal for us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." So it's a little bit of what's going to happen next week. But that scripture there is therefore there. And we should always look back to what he was saying before. And the 11 to 19, he speaks the ministry of reconciliation. He's talking about reconciling people to God by our living and the way that we speak. So it's for everyone. I know the initial Great Commission was to the apostles and they were given great powers. But it's every one of us to proclaim God in our lives, in every element of our lives. So on our journey through next couple of weeks, we're going to look at these verses and we're going to pick over them. I love doing this. And look at what God is telling us through the Lord Jesus Christ and how we can have our mission being profitable. So before we do that, let's have a word of prayer. Dear God, I pray that the Holy Spirit may take out my feeble words and turn them into words of wisdom. As we look at this passage, we thank you for the clear signs that you've given us. Lord, oftentimes we have very confusing signs, but you've given us such clear signs, and you've been very honest about how our mission will go. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, first of all, as Jesus often does, he gives a reality check to his disciples. Now, don't forget, he just performed 3 great miracles, hadn't he? The dead girl that was risen to life. Then there was the woman with the issue of blood, and that was cured by just a touch to his garment, to the tassels of his garment. Then he'd healed a blind person, and that was mute and blind, and they spoke and they could see. So the disciples must have been thinking, we're on a winning team here. We're going to have so much fun following Jesus. You wouldn't you? There you are. Following this man was doing all these miracles, had all this power. Then it says in verse 35, Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." So he'd done all these great works, and they were with Jesus, so with their leader, and it became very easy to follow him, trailing in his footsteps, as it were. But he's saying, look, I'm not going to be here forever, and it's not always going to be easy. But he said, it's going to be difficult, and he goes into some detail there. But you must pray for workers to continue with this work. It's not me just down to you 11, he's saying. We're going to have a big army of people that will help proclaim the new kingdom of God that I'm proclaiming here. So there it is, the command to go into the world later on, the command to preach the gospel, the good news about the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what the gospel means. So as we go through verses 35 to 38, we look at how Jesus was doing all these things out of compassion. He was healing them. He was telling them about the gospel. And as I said before, he healed many, many people. But there was only 135 in that upper room. The upper room after he'd risen from the dead and gone into heaven. The upper room where the disciples were. There was only 135 people, about 135 people. And yet he healed thousands and thousands of people. So he's saying, look, I have compassion on them, but I know they're not going to follow me. And that must be an example to us, doesn't it? He said there is a plentiful harvest out there, but the harvesters are few, so you need to pray. Then he sets out his pattern for mission. And that's in 10 verses 1 to 15. First thing to notice of the people he chooses there. Now, Jesus called his disciples to him, verse 1, gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus. Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. Now, let's just think about this very odd bunch of people. And they are an odd bunch of people. First, you've got four rough and ready fishermen. Two of the fishermen were known as the Sons of Thunder. Well, that'll give you an idea of what they were like. A short-tempered fisherman. Wow. And then they had someone called Thaddeus that we know absolutely nothing about and he's never mentioned again. Bartholomew, again, never mentioned again. And then Matthew the tax collector, someone that was hated by everyone, I should imagine, at one time. And James, son of Alphaeus, we don't know a lot about him either. Simon the Zealot is interesting. Do you know what a zealot was? Someone that would take arms up against the Roman. They were like a vigilante. They would go out and commit crimes against the Roman state. They were pledged to get rid of the Romans by violence. And he took him and made him one of his disciples. And then, of course, Judas Iscariot, who was chosen for the one task of betraying him. But you can see from this group of people that he chooses who he wants to choose, and no one is outside his remit. I've heard people say, well, I'm too bad. I'm too inconsistent to be a disciple of Jesus. Rubbish. Look at this group of people. And they were dispirited people. Do you remember when Jesus was arrested in the garden? They all ran off. It was only John that followed at a distance. And then he didn't have any clothes on. We won't go into that. Anyway, John was scared, and all the other disciples were scared, and Peter followed at a distance, that brave Peter, and then denied Jesus twice. And yet this was the group that Jesus chose to proclaim the gospel. And those 130 in the room were the small group that went out and spread the gospel through the world. And so much so in Jerusalem that it said it turned the whole of Jerusalem upside down because they had the power of the Holy Spirit within them, like these disciples had. And they were able to convert people through the power of the Holy Spirit. Those 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or any town of the Samaritans. And this is interesting. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, proclaim this message. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those who have leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. They were told to go to their hometowns. Now that's interesting. As missionaries, and we all are missionaries, we think of the word missionary as people going to different lands, don't we? We do, don't we? Well, actually, Jesus said, you go to your own people first. And I'm a great believer that missionaries who go to other parts of the world, and that's great, must first do a home mission. They must be good in their churches. They must be good at talking to people in their churches. They must be evangelizing. They must be talking to people in their own churches. Because Jesus said that to them, go to your own people. and then go to the whole world in Matthew 28. So the home mission field is very important. It's incredibly important. Every one of us are missionaries. But you say, I don't know enough. You know enough of why Jesus has saved you. And that's enough. Look at the publican in the story of Jesus. Spoke about those who were in the temple. Do you remember the story he told about the publican and the Pharisee in the temple? He said they both went up to the temple to pray. That's good. They both went up. And the Pharisee stood there and said, I thank you, Lord, that I fast 3 times a week. I do this, I do that, blah, 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 blah. And I'm not like this horrible sinner over there. And the sinner just beat his chest and said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And that person, Jesus said, went home more justified, never sinned, than the Pharisees, because his prayers didn't go out. You see, God uses people like the publican. He uses the feeble to surprise the wise, as Paul said in another place. So don't ever think you're not able to be a missionary, because you all are in your own way. So that's the first thing. It was the home mission that Jesus said. Go firstly to your own people. But also, it was a faith mission, wasn't it? In verse 9 to 10, it says this. Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. No bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or staff for the workers. For the worker is worth his keep. So they were told to go out and to do these things, but they weren't given vast amount of money. He said, go and do what you can with the goods that you have. And I think this is important to know. Don't try and be super intelligent or super, know all the answers before you start evangelizing, before you start telling people about Jesus. But what you have, God will use if you use it honestly. And that's what he's saying here. But also, it was sensible mission. You just don't go and not be sensible. He says this in verses 11 to 15. You see how Jesus lays it all out very clear. Not like my signs all over the place. If I followed them, those signs, I would have been in the bush 1 minute and up the tree the next. But this is sensible mission, because Jesus places where you should do and what you should do. In verses 11 to 15, he says this. Whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy persons. Stay in their house until you leave. That's sensible, isn't it? Find someone that you can go along with. As you enter the home, give it your greeting. If the home is deserving, let your peace rest on it. If it's not, let your peace return to you. Don't persist if you're not wanted. That's what he's saying. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, leave that home or town and shake the dust off your feet. So the resources that we have, God gives us, we go out with. But we must also be sensible. We mustn't do something that we can't do. So, for example, if somebody asks you, as a new Christian or someone, to do a lecture on the doctrine of sanctification and you haven't a clue what you're talking about, don't go and do it. That's silly, isn't it? But if you're asked to say why you are a Christian, you can say it in your own simple words. But also to go out and to do things within your resources. But also that verse 14 needs an extra interpretation. People say, what's all this about, brushing the dust off them? So why did Jesus tell his disciples to shake the dust off their feet? So I looked into this. If a city or a home wouldn't welcome them. So the Jews were told, when leaving Gentile cities, pious Jews often shook the dust from their feet to show their separation from Gentile practices. If the disciples shook the dust off a Jewish town from their feet, it would show their separation from the people that were making a wrong choice. You see how this goes? That the opportunity to choose Christ may not present itself again. So they're shaking off, they're keeping on, they're going on, they're talking to that person. I'm sure you've had that. And they say, I don't want to know. And there comes to a point when you don't talk to them about Jesus Christ, but you pray for them. But the thing is here, are you receptive to the teachings from God? And if you ignore the Holy Spirit pointing you to God, And that's what it is, people talking to you, the Holy Spirit saying, have you considered you may not get another chance? In another place it says about the unforgivable sin. And the unforgivable sin was to blaspheme against the Holy Spirit. And blaspheme against the Holy Spirit is saying, I don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't believe in his power. I don't believe in the Holy Spirit. I don't believe in these things. And keep doing that, and God will sometimes harden your heart. How do I? Why do I say that? Because in Scripture it tells you that. Pharaoh, it said that Pharaoh in Egypt there, that God hardened his heart. That seems strange, doesn't it? He kept refusing the two people of God, and God hardened his heart, so it ended in disaster. So I plead with you, if you've heard the claims of the gospel, think about it, don't reject them, and come to the Lord Jesus Christ, because there may be a time when you can't. And then verse 15 is very sad. It says this, truly I tell you, it will be more bearable for Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. Now, Sodom and Gomorrah were a wicked city, and God destroyed that city. But they didn't have the advantages that you have now. They didn't have the whole Bible. They didn't have the people telling them about the Lord Jesus Christ. They didn't have that. And Jesus is saying, it will be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah if you refuse to see the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, the good news about the Lord Jesus Christ. But it also shows us, first it shows us it's a home mission to start with, it's a faith mission, we go in faith, it's a sensible mission, you don't do things that you can't possibly do, and that it will be a difficult mission. And we know that, don't we? But let's verses 16 to 23. I'm sending you out like sheep among wolves. Whoa, hang on a minute, the disciples say. Sheep among wolves? That's not good. They're farming people. That's not good. Hang on, that's got my attention. Therefore, be of shrewd as snakes and innocent as doves. That's a beautiful saying, isn't it? Shrewd as snakes. Snakes. Sneaky snakes. But as harmless as doves. Beautiful. So just use your common sense. Be on your guard. You'll be handed over to local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. It doesn't paint a very good picture here, isn't the mission, isn't it? He's not saying it's all going to be rosy. It's all going to be amazing. Do you know, I get really cross when I hear preachers saying, you come to Christ and everything will be rosy. What a load of rubbish. I'm sorry, it's not true. In one way it's true, because you have Christ within you to help you in every situation. But he's never promised you it would be rosy. Look at this. Look at these verses. Be on your guard, you will be handed over to local councils and be flogged in the synagogues. That's not very rosy, is it? On my account, you will be brought before governors and kings as witnesses to them and to the Gentiles. That's an incredible opportunity to witness to people that you wouldn't ever be able to witness to. I remember hearing a story about Billy Graham. The Queen wanted him to have a private audience with her. And he went to a private audience. Well, that was wonderful, wasn't it? And he was able to give the gospel to our Queen then. But when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say. And here it is. Here's the example of how Jesus doesn't leave you there in absolute despair. Do you imagine the disciples thinking, well, he's not really selling this, is he? He's not really selling this. But then he goes on to show what he will do for them. It says in verse 19, when they arrest you, do not worry about what to say or how to say it. At that time, you will be given what to say. You'll be given by the Holy Spirit what to say. For it will not be you speaking, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. That's wonderful, isn't it? In another place in Scripture, it talks about us being the temple of the Holy Spirit. And we go over that and we think about that. But that's the Spirit of God dwelling in our hearts, that when we need him, we can rely on him. But it gets worse before it gets better here. And this must have hurt them as well. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child. Children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. You will be hated by everyone because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. one that stands firm to the end will be saved. That's wonderful, isn't it? But there will be times of trouble, and it may be your family don't know why you're doing it. It may be your brothers and sisters say you're stupid doing it. But carry on, Jesus is saying. Carry on doing it because you have that faith in me. Carry on, I will give you help. When you are persecuted in one place, flee to another. Truly I tell you, you will not finish going through the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. So he gives us this positive final perseverance of the saints. He's saying here, you will be preserved to the end. Now, where's my piece of paper? Oh, I've lost it. There we go. I'm going to give you a doctrinal lesson now. Oh dear. Okay. A great man called John Calvin had this wonderful way of proclaiming doctrines. And he put this acronym. Is it called an acronym? Yes. Yeah. Anyway, and he it's the word tulip, which describes how he believes, and I believe, that the Bible is talking about us and how we become Christians and why we can't do it ourselves. And the first one is total depravity, unable to save yourself. That's what he's saying. You're not able to save yourself. Christ has to do it for you. Unconditional election. That means there is nothing that we can bring to God to say, here, I've got this little bit of goodness. You can add that to your salvation. No, it's unconditional election. That means God saves you as you are, a sinner, dead in sins. Then there's limited atonement. Not everyone will be saved. And that's the sad news. Limited atonement. Not everyone will be saved. But there is irresistible grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. Remember, that's how you remember grace. And if God chooses you, you cannot resist. Wow. So if God says, I want you, you cannot resist. And that's amazing, isn't it? And it's something to be proud of. And to think, I haven't chosen God, but God has chosen me. Irresistible grace. But this is the one I want to come to at the end. The perseverance of the saints. Once in Christ, always in Christ. Once you've made that commitment to Christ and you sincerely have said, I want Jesus in my life, I want him to change my life from inside out, he will be there for you throughout thick and thin, whatever you've done or wherever you've been, however deep you've gone into sin, he will be there with you. The perseverance of the saints is a wonderful doctrine. And I hate people who say you can come in and out of Christ. You cannot. And to say so, you're making Christ and God a liar on the cross, because he died for those he died for, the limited atonement. He died for everyone he knew who he died for on the cross, all those that came to believe in him. But the perseverance of the saints is magnificent, isn't it? We'll get there in the end because God will help us. Paul had the right idea. To me, to live is Christ, to die is gain. What would you do with this man? Say, Paul, stop preaching the gospel. No, I won't do it. Well, I'll kill you. That's all right. I'll go to heaven. Well, then we'll leave you alive. That's good. I'll live for Christ. They couldn't do anything with Paul, and they can't do anything with us. And it doesn't matter what they can do to us. We have the final perseverance of the saints, and we'll be with Christ in heaven. That's something to praise God for, isn't it? Hallelujah. So verse 23, just going to finish on this one today. Has a lot of ideas from commentators what this means. I'll just read it to you again. It's a strange verse. When you are persecuted, in one place, flee to another. Truly I tell you, you will not finish going through the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. Now there's lots of theories on this by commentators. But a lot of them say this, and I think this is a good, sensible one to follow. It's that we have not got time to go into it, but by the most popular one, it's a reference to the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. It said that when some of the disciples are still alive, the word coming is used as many in the scriptures to show judgment from God. He's saying before the judgment of God comes in the destruction of the temple, which Jesus spoke about many times, this temple will be destroyed because of your evilness, because you have rejected me, some of the disciples were still alive. And that's true, they were. So that's how I'm going to leave with that. You may discuss that with me afterwards. There are many other theories on this, but I feel that makes a sense. So just to recap this week, Jesus shows us that mission is for all, not just for missionaries and people that know all scriptures or very well read in scripture. He suggests that we start at home. Mission starts at home, in our home maybe, with our friends. We need faith to continue, particularly in difficult times. We need common sense. Of course we need common sense. If you want to be a preacher and you can't can't put two or three words together, then you're not going to be a preacher, are you? Although maybe in some cases you can be. But you know what I mean. You've got to have common sense. Then it will be difficult. If we were doing it right, it will be difficult. You will have people that will go against you. You will have people that will rile against you. We need to be alert to the dangers. Just don't wander in. We need to be ready to defend ourselves. We need to have an answer for what we believe. But, and this is the big but, don't worry, we will be helped. And finally, we have final perseverance with Christ. And that's amazing, isn't it? That should help us through all these other problems. Jesus never sugarcoated the gospel and the mission that he was asking you to do. But he also never left us down there. He always brought us up there. He gave us a reason to continue. So next week we'll be looking at 24 to 42. That's your homework for this week. Look at those verses. Jesus shows us the nature of our mission, what we're going to do in our mission, what we're going to do, the nuts and bolts, as it were, or the building bricks of our local body of Christ here in Cheney. Because every church is a local body of Christ. Did you know that? We're all joined together in all our different parts. A body has different parts, doesn't it? Obviously, it has hands and feet and other parts of the body that make them work. And Paul, in his great analogy in 1 Corinthians, talks about all the different parts working together as the body of Christ. And that's what Jesus is saying here. We all work together in this mission. But next week we'll look at that. So I hope that you got something out of this morning of my ramblings and that you understood that Jesus is telling us everyone is part of this mission. Everyone is proclaiming the word of God. We're to do it with sensibility, but we're to do it with faith, and we have that final perseverance of the saints that God will bring us through. So let us pray. Dear Lord, I thank you for this passage. Lord, I don't think I've done it justice, but Lord, I pray that these words may help us all to understand that we're all missionaries. Here at the mission at Cheyley, help us to be good missionaries, good ambassadors for you, that we may persuade others to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for listening.
Just before we come to our final hymn, just to say we're doing a special collection today for the earthquake victims in Turkey and Syria. I don't know which charity we're giving to. Tearfund? Tearfund, probably. The powers that be over there, the great men in our company will decide. But if you wish to give today, we're taking a special collection for that earthquake. And I guess put it in the box at the back and it'll be sent from there. So we're going to sing our final hymn, which is O Church Arise.
Sing with me, O Church Arise.
O Church Arise.
And tell, O Church of God, arise, go in the strength which Christ your Lord supplies. Go to all nations his great name adore and serve him, Lord and King, for evermore. Amen.
Amen.